new day, nice sunny day.
Try to get rolling here and get this thing sheathed, ready for, you know, drying.
Anyway, yesterday we didn't have these bird blocks. That's what we call them. Their screen in here allows air in and no bugs, technically.
You know, and there are no flies or bees or anything that get in the attic.
Anyway, air has to be able to get in at the bottom of the, you know, at the eaves here, and travel up and get out the top. That's the best way to ventilate a roof, and that's what we have to do. So, not every one of these blocks in between the trusses is a bird block or a vented block. I just went every other one. I mean, the more the better. It could be every one, but we're doing every other one. Dave's up there nailing. He nailed the solid ones in yesterday. Today's nailing in the vented blocks. Imagine what's going to happen here. The reason these blocks are way out here is we're going to run with a flat piece of soffit material. And then right here, you're going to see that upside down LP paneling. It's visible from the bottom. It looks good. That's why we're going to put it upside down. And that will be the beginning of our roof sheeting. You know, we'll put the rest of the roof sheets, stack them on, you know, right to those, and just go like the wind. Okay, let's go on the other side and I'll show you. I thought I'd mention, so we talk about simple solutions sometimes. We need to run those blocks along here at a very particular spot. The tails are good. I talked about how we're not going to cut the tails. So we made this jig on the last building. It rests on the end of the tail. You set it on the top, slide it up till it won't slide up anymore. I make a line. It's a little silly, but I go along here and I make a line. This little jig assures that I will mark each one the same and that the blocks will be put the same distance from the end of the tail. Just a little way to save time. Took a couple minutes to make this jig. So at least if one is wrong, they're all wrong. And the things that look, you know, mistakes that are obvious are the ones that stick out, right? If the whole house is leaning one way, you really don't notice that. If one part of the house is plumb and the rest of it's leaning, that's the part you notice. So, one point I'll make, when I laid this roof out for where these trusses are going to go, I had a choice. I could have centered them, and you know, a lot of times what I will do is come from the outside and measure, you know, 23 and a quarter and away. That puts the center of this truss at 24 inches, and that makes the sheets go all the way to the outside of this gable. But that's not really what I want to happen. I've explained, I think, that I want this overhang plywood, the stuff I'm standing on here, I want this to go, you know, from the outside of the building to the middle of this truss. And then the other roof sheets we put on will go to the middle of this gable truss. Anywho, long story longer, I pulled from this side and I went 24 and away, 48 and away, 60, 72 and away. Everything is away. So I'll be able to start with full uncut sheets. You know, full 8-foot sheet, then I'll use a 4-foot sheet, 8-4, 8-4. But I won't have to cut it. When I get down to the other end, I will have to take an inch and a half off. That's the end where I'm doing all my cutting, and that is intentional. That's so that I don't have to cut both ends. Helps to have a big, strong guy working with you, always. Okay, you gotta
feed him. Hey, thanks.
You gotta feed him at lunchtime. That does get a little spandy, doesn't it? So we're putting these sheets down. I'm double checking layout just while we get started here. It just helps the next batch that we put on to make sure. Anyway, we're laying out where we should nail the tops of these trusses just to get them on track. Right. I was going to mention, nailing is different on the edges than it is usually in the field. When I say on the edge, it's around the perimeter of the sheet. You know, around here for this building, they can be no more than 6 inches apart. In the field, 12 inches usually is the rule. The nails have to be spaced 12 inches apart in the field. That means everything other than the edge, okay? Edge nail, nailing, and field nailing. That's the way it is referred to. Out here on the end, and on both ends, I am not nailing the gable truss or the first truss in because they're tied together. We're laying these sheets down. When we get to the top, I'm going to snap a line on there where I want the middle of that truss to be. I'll cut them off with my saw. This end I won't cut off, just this end. But that allows me to move that in or out where I want it to be and make it nice and straight so that everybody's happy for years and years to come.
Hanging over just a tiny bit.
Well, hit the bottom, very bottom. Go ahead and nail here.
Like it?
Yep. It's worth mentioning, you know, we talk about staggering the end joints of the sheets. What that means is, you know, this bottom piece we put on, we put a full 8-foot piece on. The next course of plywood we put on, we want to stagger the end of the sheet of plywood. So I'll start with a 4-footer this time, and then we'll go 4-footer. 8, 8, 8, 4 on that end. The next course, 8-footer all the way across. 8, 8, 8, 8. Next course, 4, 8, 8, 8. It doesn't always have to be offset a complete half of a sheet, but it needs to be offset at least one truss bay, if you want to call it that.
Yep. And why do we have to stagger the sheathing?
It makes it stronger. Just imagine if I ran the seams of all the plywood sheets in the same place all the way up the roof. If I tried to pull that roof apart, it would be much easier to break that board that they're nailed into. The board would just split. When I stagger the sheets, it has to actually rip each sheet in half, and it's just much, much stronger. I mean, it doesn't take a whole great imagination to imagine how much stronger it could be. So now if the sheets are staggered and I'm trying to rip the roof in two, it has to actually rip a sheet of plywood, and the plywood is, I mean, it's called shear. It's strong. The other thing to recognize is this strand board, OSB, has a side that is supposed to go up. The side that is supposed to go up is, it's got some gription to it. It makes sense that on the roof you would want the rough side to be up. Boy, if that smooth side is up and it gets a little bit of sawdust on it, or just straight up, it is slick. Another way to tell that this is the side that is supposed to go up, it has marks on there for where I am to nail it. They've indicated, you know, there's marks at 16 inch on center and there's marks at 2 foot on center. Obviously, I'm going to use the marks that are on 2 foot. You know, this is a barge board. We ran the sheeting on top of the barge board. It's typical to run a piece of 1x2 over, you know, flush with the top of the sheeting to cover up the end of the sheet. You know, a lot of times they'll put metal flashing over here before they roof, does the same thing. But we're trying to hide the edge of the sheet. We don't want that exposed. This is just a way to do it. Anyway, we're covering up the edge of the sheet.